coming up on Shawele Road.
Hello there. My name is Dixon Wasake, and I am a servant of Jesus the Christ. Today I'm speaking about a beautiful topic about the beauty of the Lord. In it, I am going to cover, one, what are the benefits of blossoming or flowering in the Lord? And two, how can you handle a season where you are just beautiful in the Spirit? Come along with me. It's going to be beautiful.
Health notice in these difficult times of coronavirus, COVID-19. Symptoms, fever, dry cough, and fatigue are most common, while thick mucus from coughs, shortness of breath, sore throat, and headache are less common. Prevention. Wash your hands, cover your cough, take care of yourself, and keep alert to the information that is provided. Also, consider social distancing, isolation from each other, and less physical contact.
So, before I go into the message, let me tell you a little bit about myself. So, before I became a devoted Christian, for about 20 years of my life, I was a hedonist. So a hedonist is someone who lives life for pleasure. You see, I cared about outer beauty, my career, getting money, until the Lord humbled me, and in May 2017, I became baptized. The Lord gave me inner beauty, and I'm pursuing Him with all my heart. You can see my full testimony on the screen. The second thing is, so we are in a season that is called blossom. So blossom is a word the Lord Jesus gave me about 12 messages that will help a Christian grow in the Holy Spirit. But what is the meaning of blossom? What does he mean? We'll come to the message, but Mr. Voice is gonna give us a few of the information notice board issues. Thank you.
And here is the information notice board. Pray for us. Without the Lord, our effort is in vain. Pray that we remain faithful, humble servants. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and keep up with our videos which support the website. Looking for a ministry to partner with? Pray, volunteer, give, subscribe to, consider supporting. The above ministry website has not paid us to provide this recommendation, and so the views expressed here do not necessarily represent the views of the ministry promoted above. Likewise, the views therein do not necessarily reflect those of this ministry.
Thank you very much, Mr. Voice. So, as I said, we are in a series called Blossom, in which the Holy Spirit is helping us grow. Now, the season of blossoming is also the season of flowering. So if you've been following this series, by the way, if you haven't, go back and watch the rest of the messages. If you've been following this series, there's something obvious you might not know. A season of flowering is beautiful, probably as bright as my yellow t-shirt, but it is beautiful. Have you ever thought about the millions of people who, for example, go to see Japanese cherry blossoms in bloom? Or have you heard of the Chelsea Flower Show? It is such a big deal. Queen Elizabeth goes to it every year. It is like her event of the year. And how many of you have gone to flower gardens? You see all the beautiful sunflowers, lavenders, chrysanthemums, carnations, like my mother used to grow. And these things can keep you beguiled for days, for ages. So flowers are such a beauty to behold. In fact, this is what the Bible says about the beauty of flowers. Consider how the wild flowers grow. They do not labor or spin, yet I tell you, not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. So you can see, according to the Bible, flowers, at least even wild flowers, God clothed them more splendidly than Solomon, the richest and wisest king that we know of in the Bible. And flowers, by the way, are a money maker. Let me give you an example. So Colombia produces about 70% of the US flowers. This is, by the way, a 1 billion trade. So flowers are a big time money maker. And of course, flowers evoke emotions. How many of you have given flowers to your moms, maybe on Mother's Day, or to your lovers, you've given beautiful red roses? So you can see flowers bring all of this emotion. And what about the smell of flowers? Flowers bring the birds and the bees. It is really, really so beautiful. So let's go back to the stages of growing for an orange tree, which is what we are covering in this season. So an orange tree, in about 5 years, goes through five stages. One, planting. Two, sprouting. And then three is growing. And then four is blossoming or flowering. Then five is cross-pollination. And then finally, six is bearing fruit. So there is an interesting connection for a Christian. In this time of flowering, natural flowers, and flowering in the spirit. So the time of flowering comes after a season of, if you want to say, darkness. For a tree, think of it, when it's planted, when it's growing, it's in the soil, it's in the dark. And then as spring is coming, the flowers start coming out and beauty starts coming out. So there is a similar connection for a Christian. For example, money. So flowers are a money maker and they bring beauty. Likewise, for you as a Christian, the time of flowering might be the time when you start getting paid for your preaching, your singing, your prophecy. Two, attention. So we know that the time of flowering is the time when everyone is looking. So we all love flowers. It's the same thing with you. The time of blossoming in the spirit could be the time of attention. People start seeing your faithful service in the Lord, your quiet hospitality for the saints. The pastor starts noticing you. The youth leader starts noticing you. Your cell group leader starts seeing your faithful service during prayer groups, during Bible study. You start getting noticed. The third thing is influence. So the time of flowering is typically the time when you maybe start getting likes on your YouTube videos like mine. You start getting a lot of people thinking of you as an influencer, as a person to pay attention to. So the question is this: what do you do during this time of, let's call it, fame? Lights, cameras, action. So to help you to handle this blossoming stage, let us look at examples from the Bible to help you put this lesson into practice. So the first thing, you must remember that this season is temporary. Hear what the Bible says. A voice was saying, "Cry out." Another said, "What should I cry out? All humanity is grass, and all its goodness is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flowers fade, when the breath of the Lord blows on them. Indeed, the people are grass. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God remains forever." So what you are starting to see is flowers are beautiful, duh, but they are temporary. So if you are in your season of blossoming, of course, celebrate it. Be joyful about it. But you must remember it is temporary. There are other stages to come. For an orange tree, like we are saying in this season, you have two more stages: pollination and bearing fruit. So the end goal is bearing fruit. And if you're not careful, you could fall into the trap like this parable that Jesus told. Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now, I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man replied, "leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down." So like I said, you have an end goal, and that end goal is to bear fruit. Now, even more dangerous than thinking beauty is the end, yet it's temporary, is the sin of pride when beauty gets to you. Let me describe to you something from the Bible. Here is a verse on beauty. "Son of man, sing this funeral song for the king of Tyre. Give him this message from the sovereign Lord. You were the model of perfection, full of wisdom and exquisite in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Your clothing was adorned with every precious stone: red carnelian, pale green peridot, white moonstone, blue green beryl, onyx, green jasper, blue lapis lazuli, turquoise, and emerald, all beautifully crafted for you and set in the finest gold. They were given to you on the day you were created. I ordained and anointed you as the mighty angelic guardian. You had access to the holy mountain of God and walked among the stones of fire. You were blameless in all you did from the day you were created until the day evil was found in you. Your heart was filled with pride because of all your beauty. Your wisdom was corrupted by your love of splendor, so I threw you to the ground and exposed you to the curious gaze of kings." Now, in case you have never known, those verses are some of the few verses in the Bible that describe Lucifer, the morning star, who became Satan, the devil, that serpent of old, who tries to deceive the saints. They show us he had ornate beauty. He was so beautiful, and God planted him in a garden. There is a coincidence, or is it, between beauty and being in a garden? Until the day he fell, he got consumed by his beauty. So the flowering stage, you can see, is the most visible stage, but it's also delicate. Men can cut you down, but worse still, God can cut you down. So, in case you're wondering, why would God create something as beautiful as a flower and it is temporary? Why would God create us people as beautiful as we are with all our gifts, and yet we are temporary? It seems God does this so that we will look at the beauty that is temporary and want to know the one behind it, and want to seek the bread of life that lasts forever. We behold that which is temporary and look and want to know who is the one who gives beauty that lasts forever. That is what we should be doing. The hope of God is that in beholding this temporary beauty and you think of the author of beauty, you will reach out and grasp for him, even though he's not far from any one of us. Beauty is seen, but that is temporary. The Lord's beauty, which is eternal, is unseen. Look at what is seen. Reach out for that which is unseen. So if you have been consumed by the beauty of what you have, your wealth, your physical looks, your intelligence, your gifts, repent. Repent from where you have fallen before the breath of God blows on you and you turn into vapor. Let's talk about our celebrity beholding generation and this scene of beauty. So you know our generation loves celebrities. We want their fame, we want their wealth, we want their beauty. But we are also a generation that is woke. Black Lives Matter. So we care for injustices. And because we care for injustices, here's the thing. We want to be celebrities, but we hate the ones who show off. So instead, we love the celebrities who are down to earth. You know, celebrities like, let's say, Tom Hanks. They say that Tom Hanks even goes on Reddit and he helps people who want to know what to do when you're down with a fever. Or he gives you tips on how to find items that are below $150. Now in America, $150 for gifts is probably cheap. If you're in another part of the world, that might seem a lot, but that's the perspective in which Tom Hanks is doing this. Another celebrity like Adele, the British musician, what she does is she does normal things like she hangs out at home and invites people over. So that is what normal celebrities, that's what celebrities do. They try to do things like normal people. Now, there is actually a lesson here. The lesson is this, and it was hammered home by a pastor called Rick Warren. If you're ever feeling consumed with pride, the first thing you should do is go home and wash some dishes. Go home and slash the grass. Go home and do some heavy lifting. Help the children do homework. That kind of normal stuff helps you remain grounded. Now, for you, man or woman of God, God gives a lesson on how you can keep grounded. And this lesson came from a lesson he gave for all kings of Israel. Now, think about it. Celebrities in our day, kings in the old times. What was the connection? What did God tell all kings of Israel to do? This is what he said. The king must not take many wives for himself, because they will turn his heart away from the Lord. And he must not accumulate large amounts of wealth in silver and gold for himself. When he sits on the throne as king, he must copy for himself this body of instruction on a scroll in the presence of the Levitical priests. He must always keep that copy with him and read it daily, as long as he lives. That way, he will learn to fear the Lord his God by obeying all the terms of these instructions and decrees. This regular reading will prevent him from becoming proud and acting as if he is above his fellow citizens. It will also prevent him from turning away from these commands in the smallest way. And it will ensure that he and his descendants will reign for many generations in Israel. So, it's a pretty powerful passage, and this was to kings. What about us commoners? Think about it. But anyway, so there are two lessons here. One, do not accumulate things. In this case, he was telling kings not accumulate women or wealth. I do not know what the Lord is telling you not accumulate, but even more important, he was saying instead of accumulating things, accumulate knowledge of God. And how do you accumulate this knowledge? By sitting at the Lord's feet daily and reading the Bible. It is this regular reading that will cause the beauty of the Lord to come upon you, the Holy Spirit to come upon you in the year of the Lord. In fact, this is what the Lord says. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and to provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. Now, if you have read the New Testament, by the way, this is in Luke from verse 4, 16 to 21. This is how Jesus introduced his ministry. He started by saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me. And he ended up by saying, the scripture had been fulfilled that day. So, for you who might have fallen, the starting point is to return to the year of the Spirit's favor. To return to the point where the Spirit is blowing upon you and helping you blossom and helping you to bear the true fruit that lasts forever, the fruit of the Spirit, which is kindness, which is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Amen and amen. So I have some next steps for you. One, examine the areas of your life where the Lord has made you beautiful. Thank him for it. Praise him for it. Two, examine the areas of your life where temporary beauty has consumed you and it has caused you to forget the one who gives true beauty. Repent from where you are fallen so that the wind of the Spirit may blow on you again. And then three, to overcome the sin of the beauty, which is pride, you have to do a number of things. One, do normal things. Two, do not accumulate things for yourself, things of this world that are temporary and fade away. Three, most importantly, accumulate God knowledge. Read the Word of God daily. I look forward to your own season of blossoming. The Lord bless you. You turn shade.